In our last program, we shared stories of people who heard God's voice audibly. But there were more stories to share than we had time for. So today, we're back with part two of Hearing God's Voice. Stay with us for this episode of Better Life Today. Hello and welcome to this episode of Better Life Today. With me is Sayuri Rodriguez. Welcome, Sayuri.
Thank you.
Today we're doing another Stories of Faith. We're actually doing a Stories of Faith part two because we already previously did one about hearing God's voice. We had too many stories,
so we
decided to do a part two, and that's what we're here to do today. We were talking about this topic, Sayuri, you told me that it reminded you of a childhood game.
Yes.
What was that?
That's the game Telephone. I don't know how many of you played that. This telephone is to remind you of that game where one person would share a message, you know, a sentence or something. The house, the black house is beautiful and there was a tree next to it. And then that person tells, whoever heard it, tells the next one and then the next one. Do you remember, right?
Yeah, they pass it from person to person,
yes,
the message.
Yes, they do. And then towards the end, what happens?
You hear the final message again, after it's gone through a number of people.
Right.
And usually it's a hilarious ending.
Yes, yes. You know, recently we played that, not recently, some years ago, the last time I played that was actually at church. It was a Bible game. So you were supposed to tell a story of the Bible, and it was the story of Moses. It ended up being like Joseph's story by the time it ended, and something about a boy drowning, and it just completely was different.
Got messed up and mangled, didn't it? Well, how does that tie into hearing God's voice?
I think that to be able to hear God's voice, we sometimes decide, you know, it's good for me to hear from other people.
The pastor.
From reading, from the pastor, yes, from this and that. But when you really want to hear God's voice personally, speaking to you directly, just go to the source.
Yeah.
You know, and God will speak directly to you because it could be that you find messages or things that are said that maybe are not what the Bible says. So that's why it's so important. And God does mention this in the Bible. It is written. It is written. Go to the Bible. God really wants to speak to you and to me and to Doug.
So the closer we stay to the source, the more accurate will be our understanding.
That's right.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. That's a good point. A good point. In this topic of hearing God's voice, we are sharing some stories of people who were able to hear either God's voice or the voice of an angel, which is kind of the same thing because God commissions his angels, go tell them this.
Right.
So either way, it's God's voice, really. But either people have heard it audibly, and that does happen, or sometimes people have been impressed with the words flashing in their mind. Something was given to them in their mind.
Mm-hmm.
I shared in a number of episodes back that that happened to me once. Something had happened in my life where I was disappointed that God had allowed something to happen.
Mm-hmm.
And so I was praying and talking to the Lord about it, and in my mind flashed the words, wait and see.
Mm.
And when I heard them, I was satisfied, and I said, okay, Lord, I'm gonna wait and see. And you know, in the end of that story, the Lord revealed his answer to me very clear.
Right.
I had to wait and see, but in waiting, I got the answer.
Mm-hmm.
So for me, it was an impression, not an audible voice. But we do have stories to share today of people who've heard that audible voice, and we wanted to pass it on. We also have stories of people who've been impressed with God's voice or the voice of the angel or the Holy Spirit telling them something.
Mm-hmm.
But we have a text that we wanted to use for today. And
we
Sayuri,
do.
Would you read that for us?
We do. The Bible verse is found in John chapter 10, verse 27. And it says, my sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me.
Can you try that one again?
Yes, let's repeat it. It says, my sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me.
It's important to be able to hear that voice, isn't it? To know
it
God,
is.
It's God's voice.
It is. And it reminds me of when I met my husband, I was actually in Maryland, and he was in California. We had mutual friends, and they kind of introduced us to each other, kind of, through internet. And so we started, our communication first started with letters. and just letters and questions and, you know, sending back and forth, back and forth. And then it was time for the phone. And I remember I was really nervous thinking, what kind of voice is he going to have, you know? Mm-hmm. Oh, but when he answered that phone and when we started talking, this deep, wonderful voice, you know, and we started communicating with each other, letters, telephone, but then came the time to meet him in person. Mm. And I remember he was going to arrive at the airport and I was gonna pick him up. It was the Baltimore airport. So I'm on my way there and I'm very nervous. And I remember when I got there, I called him, but he was on the plane. So, you know, you're not able to answer right away. And I left him a message saying, I'm really, really nervous. Before we meet, why don't we stay on the phone for a little bit? I was just too nervous, right? And he got there, and yes, he was on the phone with me, and I was on the phone looking everywhere thinking, is he looking at me? Where is he? But once we saw each other, mm-hmm. of course I had seen pictures, right? Mm-hmm. So once we saw each other, I remember just putting that phone down and just walking towards him. He's walking towards me, and then we hugged, and then he kind of wanted like, okay, well, let's continue talking. And I was just like holding on to him, and I was like, just keep talking, in my ear, because I was just so used to his voice, you uh-huh. know? And I think that this Bible verse, it talks about my sheep, they know my voice. You know that when there's like a little sheep, right? And they're not behaving and they're disobedient and they're going their way. Many times, I think our viewers know, you see a picture of Jesus holding
the sheep on his shoulders,
yes, right?
Yes.
And I did some research and it turns out that he does that, or shepherds, back in those days, they would do that so that the sheep would get used to the voice of the shepherd.
Oh.
And I believe that just like with my husband, I was so used to just keep on talking, you know, this is comfortable. We should be comfortable enough to say, oh yes, this comes from God, you know, from our Bible.
Voice. You reminded me of a beautiful picture by Nathan Green, I believe it was.
Mm-hmm.
And he has that shepherd holding the sheep on his shoulders, but you know, the one thing that's distinctive uh-huh. in this painting he did was that the sheep is black,
uh-huh.
the black sheep.
Yeah.
And here you have the shepherd carrying, lovingly carrying the black sheep
yes.
to the fold.
And another thing that he reminds me of is my husband, ever since he was two or three, I don't know, he was already talking to other people. I couldn't hear him. If you had put us in a room, I wouldn't be able to distinguish his voice at that moment. But once we started communicating, using the phone, the letters and everything, now you can put me in a room with 100 people and I hear his laughter or his voice and I know that's my husband.
Yeah.
And the more we get to know the Lord, the more we're able to distinguish, this is the voice of God.
Yes, yes. Well, we want to share some stories that have come in from our viewers.
Yes.
And after one of our programs, I happened to be here on a Sunday, and one of our programs just ended, and the phone rang.
Mm.
I picked it up. It was a viewer that had just watched one of the Stories of Faith programs.
Oh, okay.
And she said, I've got a story to share. Oh. And so I got my computer set up and started typing notes, because a lot often there'll be so many details, mm-hmm. there's no way I can remember it.
Mm-hmm.
And so I have the notes with me to help me remember. This story came from a lady, her name is Joyce, and she was watching. Maybe you're watching now, Joyce. Joyce wanted to share her story with me, and it went something like this. I'll try to get all the details correct. She said she grew up a Christian, and back in 1995, she used to homeschool her children with a girlfriend of hers. In other words, the two families would get together and homeschool together. They had about six kids there at the little homeschool they had. But this lady, Joyce, had two children.
Mm.
She said that they would go to a little cabin on a piece of property, and that's where they would have school, okay. if I understood her correctly. One day she went out there, or was going out there, and she had the kids, and she put them in the back of an open pickup. So she's in the back, loads them up the tailgate. She had the tailgate open. She got the kids up into the back mm-hmm. of the pickup. So they're in the open back, right?
Right.
And then she was going to go around to the front to drive it.
Mm-hmm.
But before she could do that, it slipped out of gear. And it started to roll backwards.
Uh-oh.
I believe she told me backwards.
With the thing open?
Well,
oh, she
more importantly, I think she might have closed it, but more importantly, the kids were in the
yes.
back. She's outside the truck. The kids are in the back.
Oh, no.
It's now rolling because it slipped out of gear. So what does a mom do? Of course, you're thinking, I got to save my kids, I got to do.
Right.
So she's trying to get into the car. She says that behind her it was, she knew there was some kind of an incline or a cliff. I don't know if she called it a cliff or a down spot. Maybe it wasn't as dramatic as a cliff, but it was. She knew that was back there, something going down. And there were things back there in the trees. So she had a limited amount of time to do something. So she's, I guess, running across, trying to do it. The door's coming. She's trying to get in the thing, trying to run.
Trying to get inside the...
Yeah, all at once. You can imagine it's just a mess. And she's worried about the kids. She sees the truck headed towards the trees. I mean, she tries to run alongside it. She's worried that she's going to get crushed. And she said about 10 feet before where the trees were, she heard an audible voice.
Oh, what did it say?
It said one word. She told me one word. Do you know what the word was?
Peace.
Close. The word was relax.
Relax.
Relax. To her, that meant to fall down on the ground.
Oh.
She fell down on the ground, and the door then swung over the top of her. She had to kind of duck to make sure it didn't hit her in the head.
Okay.
But the bad part was that the wheels went over her leg, a large portion of her leg.
Wow.
I said, did it hurt? She goes, no, it didn't feel it. She says she was running on adrenaline.
Yeah.
She said it didn't hurt.
So worried.
But it happened. And so she didn't get hit in the head, but it did run over her leg. She ducked down, and she said it was about springtime, so the ground wasn't that hard.
Mm-hmm.
That helped. And she didn't have any broken bones.
Mm.
Okay, that was the good part. She later found out. But she jumped up. She said her boot came off. She yelled to her boys to jump. Now, she said it would have been about a 5-foot jump. And her kids were, what did I say? They were just young kids.
Yeah.
They were 3 and 5. 3 and 5 year old. Okay, so imagine a 3 and a 5 year old. She's telling them to jump. They jump out of the back of the truck and they make it. They're safe. They're not injured. The truck continues down now and ends up crashing in these barrels, kinds of a thing. It actually punctured one of the barrels and diesel was coming out, but she thought it was fuel. So she's thinking, it's going to blow up. I don't want it to blow up, blow me up, you know. I don't want the kids to see me blow up. But she later found out it was diesel, which I guess is less flammable.
Wow.
But she got back in the truck and pulled it forward. So everything in the end was okay. But her leg, black and blue. And eventually she realized she had to go somewhere. So she went to the local clinic and said, this is what happened to me. They took one look at her and said, you have to go to the hospital. They've got to scan you to see if any blood clots have formed.
Right.
I guess that's a big concern. And so she ended up going to the hospital. And as she was being looked over by the technicians in the hospital, or the doctor, they were talking, does she have a clot, but how many do you think she has?
Oh, wow.
So they were looking over, and then they came back and they said something to the effect of, we don't know how this happened, but you don't have any blood clots. There's nothing.
Wow.
They said, we've never seen this much tissue damage without blood clots, but you don't have any. So
and
she was blessed.
Them.
I mean, they did run over her, but no broken bones, no blood clots. Her children were safe, and everything ended up being okay. And she heard the voice say,
relax.
Relax.
Because if she had not?
If she had not, who knows what would have happened.
Yeah.
And we'll have more stories, but stay with us. We have to take a break. We'll be right back. Hello, and welcome back to Better Life Today. We're doing a Stories of Faith program. And Sayuri, we've been talking about the Lord speaking to people, either in their mind or audibly.
Right.
And you had a story you wanted to share.
Yes, it's a personal story. And I was thinking about this story and I thought, I probably shared it already. And I have not, and it's one of my favorites. But this story happened to my husband and I years ago when we were living in San Jose.
Mm-hmm.
Every morning, one of our prayers is for God to give us divine appointments.
Mm-hmm.
And that morning, Sabbath had gone by. You know, Sabbath, you spend it usually at church.
Mm-hmm.
And Sunday came, and that had been a very busy Sabbath. So we were tired Sunday morning.
Yes.
And then my husband says, I forgot to tell you, I have a Bible study to give at the church today. The guy is not able to make it any other day.
Oh.
And I remember thinking, today, I was so tired.
Yeah.
But the more that he talked about this Bible study, I was impressed. Go with him. Go with him. But I myself, you know, was also pushing. No, I could have done this and this in the house. Anyway, I ended up going.
Mm-hmm.
And as we were driving over there, the church that we were at, this church, San Jose Central, around the church is not very safe. And because of that, the church put this fence and this gate that you open with a control. Mm-hmm. And Sabbath, of course, is open the whole day. During the week, if somebody's there, they open and people come in. Sunday, most of the time it was closed. Mm-hmm. That day we arrived, the gate was closed. We opened the gate, we go inside, we park, we go inside the church. And the young man that my husband was gonna give the Bible study to, he got there. And I thought, well, I'm going to go and decorate my husband's office or something. I go to his office, he goes to the fellowship room, and not even 5 minutes after we both separated to different rooms, he comes running to the office and he says, baby, baby, you need to come. There's a lady crying and she wants to see a woman. Mm. She doesn't want to talk to men, she just wants to talk to a female. So I come outside and yes, there's this lady and she's crying heavily, like—
Sobbing?
Yes, sobbing. Not able to control herself. And so I said, you know, come with me, let's go to the church and we can talk. And she was happy that there was a female there, you know, a woman. And she said, I can only talk to you. And first she couldn't stop crying. And I'm thinking, Lord, what do I say? What do I do? Well, then she started telling me her story. And she said that she had arrived to San Jose the day before. Never been in San Jose before. And as they were driving her and her husband towards San Jose, she remembers a breach, and that's all she could remember. They went to a friend's house, they were having a birthday party, and she discovered something very horrible at that party that her husband had done. Mm. It was so horrible that she remembers dropping everything she had and she just started running in the street. She didn't have her purse, nothing. And just running, running, and she would stop for a little bit and continue running, crying and crying and thinking, I did not know that I had this man as my husband for what she had witnessed. Crying and crying, and then it started getting dark. Could you imagine being in a city? And San Jose is a pretty large city. And not knowing the city, just running, running, no purse, no nothing. And the problem was so horrible. She couldn't remember numbers or people. She just, her mind was in the horrible thing that she had witnessed. Mm-hmm. Well, she stopped and she said she saw this bush around a house. And she said, well, that's where I'm going to spend the night. And she just sat down and she said, it was so cold. But she said, I was not worried about how cold it was. Mainly, it was just everything in my mind of all, you know, I used to have houses and now I have nothing. Everything is over. I never want to go back with this man. And as she was crying there, she decided, why leave? Why? I just want to take my life. And so she decided that she was going to do that the next day. And she remembered the bridge. So she said, I'm going to go to that bridge and I'm going to jump and end it here.
Wow.
So when the morning came, she got up and she started walking, thinking, I think he was on this side, starts walking, walking, walking. And then she remembered that her mom, when she was a little girl, used to take her to a Seventh-day Adventist church. Mm. And she remembered that and she said, well, God, if you're there, if you don't want me to take my life, help me to find a Seventh-day Adventist church. But I can see the bridge from here, she said. So it's gonna have to happen fast because I'm blocks away from the bridge. Mm-hmm. So help me to find a Seventh-day Adventist church. As she continues walking, do you know where our church was at?
Where?
Right next to the bridge.
Amazing.
The location of the church is right next to the bridge, right before you go into the bridge. So as she's walking, she's thinking, it's just right here. I don't see a church. And then she turns around and she sees the sign, Seventh-day Adventist Church. Mm. And she stopped herself. She was like, is this for real? She looks at the church and the gate is open.
Which it usually is not.
Usually is not. And so she decides to start walking towards the church. And then she tells God, one more thing. I don't want to talk to a man. Mm. And so if there's no ladies in there, I'm running back here, I'm going to the bridge, and I'm killing myself.
Wow.
So she goes inside, And to her surprise, there's two men. So she starts crying and crying, and my husband tries to help her. And she says, I just wanted a woman. Why couldn't I just talk to a woman? And then he says, my wife is here. And he goes and he brings me out. And then she starts crying, and she's telling me all of this. And I'm just like, praise the Lord. Thank you, God, for impressing me to come, for the gate to be open, and now there's a female. I'm here. But then I started telling God, so what do I tell her? I mean, this is a big, big problem. How do I comfort her? How do I help her? I started reading some Bible verses, but she would even like fall on her knees in the church and cry and scream, why, God, why? And then I started singing to her. She was just crying, and I just felt like nothing was helping. And then I felt impressed. It was not an audible voice, but I felt impressed, God saying, this too shall pass. I had heard that weeks before in a funeral of a lady who loved saying that. And I remember when I felt impressed by that, I thought, that's just so little. This too shall pass. It's not gonna help her. Give me a quote or, you know, I don't know. But very impressed, tell her, this too shall pass. So finally, I said, this too shall pass. And she stopped crying, looked at me, and she said, my mom used to say that.
Oh.
And so for me, remembering that experience is remembering a God who spoke to us. Impression, voice, you know, how amazing God is that he cares for his children. And when you're willing to, we prayed for divine appointments. Mm-hmm. He speaks to you and
so
he brings people.
You made yourself available.
Amen.
And the Lord knew the few little words that she needed to hear. They would bring her comfort in that moment. Mm-hmm. And he gave those words to you. Mm-hmm. Even weeks before, he started giving those words to you. And then when the time came, he said, now is the time to say those words.
And when not wanting to go, go, impress, go, I need you to be there.
Yeah, the fact you were even there, the doors were even open. God said, I need this to happen in this order, and I need these things ready for my child who's going to need some help.
Yes.
That is just amazing. How'd that make you feel after you realize the whole situation?
Wow. Just blessed, you know, an instrument to be able to be used by the Lord.
That is an awesome story. That needs to go into a book. Well, we have another story. Adrian, a friend of yours?
Yes.
Adrian shared his story with us. And this, once again, is hearing God's voice in an impression. Let's hear what Adrian's story was about. He says, every individual has a desire to love and be loved. I was no different. I developed a habit of praying at night for God to lead me to the right woman and to prepare me for her. I became determined on finding the right one, and that's all I would pray for. It seems like he knew what he wanted, huh? Yes. It wasn't until this one night, as I was praying for my future wife, that God spoke to me. I had so focused on praying and asking that I never gave time to listen. I remember hearing a clear, small voice that said, how do you expect to be in an earthly relationship when our relationship isn't consistent? It was in that moment that reality struck me. I wasn't faithful to God in everything. I realized I needed to focus on my most important relationship before I could proceed to another. I remember crying as I came to that solemn rebuke. I thanked God for speaking to me on that night, and I felt relief to know that he still cared for me and wanted me to work my personal relationship with him. Sometimes God's voice comes in a rebuke.
Yes.
You're not doing the right thing.
A command, a rebuke, sometimes to comfort.
Yeah.
I have a story of a young lady who's heard the voice of the Lord, and it was to comfort her. Her name is Sulema. We also know this young lady, and she said that in her childhood, she experienced very, very painful things. And many times, the memories would come to her, and she would feel very depressed, very sad about it. And one day, she was laying down on the bed, and she said that the memories from her childhood started coming to her. She started getting very sad, very sad. And then she started praying, God, please take these memories away. And then she heard a voice, And she said that the voice was audible and it said, "It's gone. It's gone."
Wow.
And she thought, "What? It's gone?" And every time the memory will start right there, she would start thinking about a memory. She would hear the voice. She said she heard the voice 5 times. "It's gone. It's gone."
Wow.
And she said that up to this day, she said she can't remember the painful memories anymore.
The Lord wiped it from her?
There's no more sadness because of those memories. She said, "I felt like a weight was lifted from my shoulders that night. I know that it was him because after that happened, I felt tremendous peace and joy in my heart." Mm. You see how he comforted her with 2 words, "It's gone."
You know, when there's a lot of people in this world who have gone through very traumatic things, mm-hmm. very traumatic things. Mm-hmm. And I believe that when the Lord comes again, and raises his saints from the grave and takes the ones who are alive with him to heaven, that he's going to essentially do the same thing mm-hmm. and say to them, "It's gone.
Right.
Your nightmares, they're gone. Mm-hmm. Your bad memories, they're gone." And they will just leave us. Mm-hmm. And we will have the pure bliss of heaven. Mm-hmm. That God has that power. You've just seen it happen for this lady.
Amen.
Yeah. Well, friends, we've had a good time sharing these stories of how God is speaking to his people, sometimes audibly, sometimes mm-hmm. in an impression. But the important part to remember is to stay close to Christ mm-hmm. so that in a relationship with him, you will hear his voice. Mm-hmm. You will know it is him, and you will know that you need to respond. And then exciting things will happen. You've just heard some of them. There's more stories to be told, and they're with you. Yeah. So stay close to God, and until the next program, Sadie, we pray that God will bless you and he will speak to you
Amen.
In one way or another. God bless you.